So first of all, thank you for joining us today for Open Education Week, and in particular, an opportunity to look at open educational initiatives here at Penn State. My name's Larry Reagan. I'm with the Center for Online Innovation and Learning and the EdTech Network, and it's our pleasure to host this program with our colleagues from the University Library Systems. Several individuals in the room have been involved in planning this event and planning, I think, other events through the week and other recognitions. But more importantly, they've been very engaged and involved in the use of open educational resources at Penn State. And that's what we're hoping to share with you today, and also to stimulate some dialogue about what we can be doing with these kinds of resources to address some of the issues that Dr. Barron has raised as priorities for the institution, but also looking at it as a way to improve our the quality of our educational system, because we have access to resources outside of what we may develop on our own. So with that, here's the game plan for today, just to kind of lay it out. In a second, I'm going to turn it over to Dean Barbara Dewey, and then you're going to hear from Joe Salem and John Schenck today. We also have two faculty members who are going to share with us their initiatives. Anna, is she in the room by any chance? Okay, terrific. And we're also going to have Mike Gallis join us. Mike is, I want to say, from Berks, if I get Schuylkill. Schuylkill. And they're going to show us a little bit of their work that they've been doing in this this initiative as well. So with that, I promised I wouldn't talk too long. You're going to get the context and sort of a institutional perspective from my good colleague, Dr. Dean Barbara Dewey. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry, and welcome, everyone. It's my pleasure as Dean of University Libraries to welcome you to today's COIL conversation on the promise of open educational resources at Penn State. In addition to my role as Dean, I'm speaking to you today as the former chair of the Open Educational Resources Task Force and as a current member of the Transforming Education Executive Committee for the implementation of the Penn State strategic plan. And transforming education, I feel, is one of the most powerful initiatives in that plan. Increasing access and affordability of educational and research materials is at the core of the mission of libraries. So I was happy to be asked by Provost Jones to chair the OER Task Force in February of 2015. That's when we began our work. The task force was charged to examine ways to increase the use of open and more affordable course content to reduce costs for students and increase access to a Penn State education in support of President Barron's access and affordability imperatives. As you will hear in a bit, the task force completed its work in August of 2016, and its report was accepted by Provost Jones in December. During that 18 months, the Penn State strategic plan was finalized, and as the task force completed its work and the strategic plan implementation structure was developed, it became clear that OER was a strategic initiative aligned with the work of the Transforming Education Executive Committee. So a working group was charged to implement the recommendations in the task force report. And you wouldn't be surprised to know that many of the people on the task force were also on this next group too. It just made a lot of sense. There is already significant work underway at Penn State, and there already was work underway even before the initial task force met, and that's something we discovered. Provost Jones often credits the high profile work at Penn State with the increased activity on open and affordable course content throughout the Big Ten Academic Alliance. The vision for the OER Working Group is that Penn State will be a leader among its peers in the adoption and creation of open and more affordable course materials through a multifaceted strategy. As chair of the task force and now as part of the strategic plan implementation that supports this initiative, I'm very pleased to see the work underway to achieve that vision and look forward to seeing the innovative approaches that will emerge to making Penn State even more of a leader in not only open educational resources, but but open access to scholarship and the research data that is generated by Penn State faculty and students, so it is truly accessible worldwide. I'd like to now ask my colleague Joe Salem, Associate Dean in the Libraries, to discuss the OER Task Force and current initiatives in greater detail. And Joe has truly been a driving force in this area. Joe?
Thank you, Dean Dewey. I'm going to talk a little bit about the task force's work in more detail, and then what we have underway and planned. And then we have some time to answer questions around that work before we hear from some of our colleagues on what their projects and what their work looks like. So one of the first things I want to tell you, we've heard some of the timeline. I want to get a little bit more into what the task force was charged to do as far as its deliverables. And also, I want to let you know that the report is available, and it's available on a pretty easy website. It's oer.psu.edu. And so that report was in response to the charge from Provost Jones in February 2015. As you'll see here, we had three deliverables. First of all, we were asked to do some proof of concept pilots pretty early on in the process. I'll describe that in just a little bit more detail. We were also asked to look at a very specific consortium, the how Penn State could participate in the Open Textbook Network. And the task force kind of expanded that to think about what are the other consortia and what are the other programs that we can join or leverage for more of open and affordable course content at Penn State. And then to develop a plan for OER adoption and creation at Penn State. And so those are the three deliverables. The report, again, was submitted in August 2016 and accepted by Provost Jones in December of the same year. So that task force really realized early on that the idea of open educational resources is probably a little bit too restrictive. There are a lot of definitions for OER and what we mean by open educational resources. Quite often, pure OER will have some kind of combination of the five or these five concepts from David Wiley. He calls them the five R's in OER: retain, reuse, revise, remix, and redistribute. In order to do all that, you have to have really wide open licensing for that content, and usually that means it's faculty authored or authored outside of the for-profit sector, which is the primary focus for open educational resources. But we wanted to think about what OER meant at Penn State and what our goals were for this work. And so the task force developed a working definition, and it still governs or guides what we're trying to accomplish, even in the new task force that is charged with implementing some of these ideas. I'll read this to you. Penn State University open educational resources are any type of educational material that are available to the university community with little or no cost. It may be the case that PSU OER with PSU OER that the nature of these open materials means that students, faculty, and staff can legally and freely copy, use, adapt, and reshare them within the university committee. The distinction there, it's not that we don't want really to be wide open and to support open educational resources, but if our goal is around access and affordability, we wanted to change the strategy a little bit and talk about affordable course content, and we can define some of those terms in just a minute, with OER as one of the strategies to meet those goals. Thinking that if we just focused entirely on faculty authored or completely open resources, we would leave a lot of what's already been developed, what has already been licensed at the university, out of that conversation, and we didn't want to do that. When I talk about what's already been developed, we have faculty colleagues who've developed what they will call open textbooks, but really it's open courseware. A good example is in chemistry. And in order to keep that sustainable, they charge a small access fee for students. Under a purely OER model, that wouldn't be part of our strategy, but we really wanted to include that kind of work in the work that we were supporting and doing. The other major investment in type of content that we wanted to make sure was available was licensed content, either through instructional design work or through the university libraries. If you're looking completely at a pure OER model, that kind of content isn't really part of that strategy. So we wanted to have an expansive view. And I think throughout the work of the task force, we were pretty successful in brainstorming with colleagues what that more expansive view could look like and what some of the resources available are and how they fit into a multifaceted approach. So in addition to defining OER, that task force did a couple of different things to meet its charge and then some. We did conduct proof of concept pilots in fall and 2015 and spring of 2016, and they're reported in the report that's available on the OER website. Fall of 2015, we really wanted to look at what was already underway at Penn State and gather some student and faculty feedback on what their initiatives look like, user satisfaction about the resources, and how well they may be supported by the departments. And then in spring 2016, one of the things that we had identified was that one of the advantages of Penn State is the really thorough and really well-developed expertise around instructional design and the investment in instructional design. So we wanted to go through the process of transitioning courses using really in-depth instructional design support, and Julie Lang provided a lot of that support or coordinated it. For faculty who are just interested in moving to OER or more affordable options, and document that process and get a sense of what is it, how much does it take here to support that, so that we can make some judgments around scalability and making that a more broad kind of strategy for OER and affordable course content. We held a OER summit in the spring of 2016, just about a year ago, as part of Open Education Week. And the focus of that event was really on what was already underway at Penn State, some of the resources that are available, and again, a little bit future focused as well. And then we had some really wide university wide consultation. We met with just about anyone who would let us meet with them. We met with AQ and the deans at UP. We went out to New Kensington to talk with the faculty and instructional designers there around the idea of, you know, if we set a goal of being completely textbook free at this particular campus, what would that look like over a certain amount of time, and got really great feedback and met with student groups and as many people as we could so that we could inform the report that we were filing. And what do we find in all that? Well, as you wouldn't be surprised, especially with being the home of something like the Dutton Institute, COIL, and teaching and learning with technology, there's already significant work underway around specifically open educational resources and then some of the more coordinated approaches to using licensed content and more affordable options. One of the things that we found, though, is that it's not really coordinated or presented in a way that allow faculty to take advantage of the services and resources that are available to them. Before the work of the task force, there wasn't an OER website. Some of the partners on campus who provide service or are active in this space have websites or support pages, but there wasn't any one place that faculty and instructional designers could go to find those resources. In the pilot work that we conducted, we did find that there was a high level of satisfaction with OER. Obviously, you could ask questions around, you know, isn't it great that this is free? But what we were really asking were key features of a lot of the OER being piloted or already in use. And we found that students were very happy with what was in use. And for most of those courses in the pilots, it was already existing content. It wasn't Penn State locally authored material. And so even with that, OER, more open textbooks as part of the bigger programs, there was a high level of student satisfaction and faculty satisfaction. Obviously, more work can be done in that area. We, as I mentioned, we decided early on that OER should be part of a larger affordable course content strategy, and that Penn State has a couple of advantages for scaling this and for being leaders in this space, especially when you look at our peer institutions like the institutions in the Big Ten. The campuses are a really big opportunity for us and a really great advantage. The campuses are an advantage from a few different perspectives. Even if we don't move completely to open or brand new licensing models for content, with a curriculum that's provided at so many different locations and so many different access points, even a more coordinated approach to assigning, let's say, even a traditional textbook can save students money and has opportunities for bringing faculty together around those multi-section courses or those points in the curriculum that can lead to some advantages in innovating within that point in the curriculum. And so what do we mean by this? In the report, we're able to show that even if a multi-section course were to adopt the same textbook, when you have a few different textbooks, there's great variation in the pricing. Even if you go into the midpoint, we show what the savings could be. And that's before you get into things around economies of scale. So if we could place larger book orders, we save even more for students. If we can commit to three-year cycles on some of these multi-section courses, you can build up your used book inventory and save students money that way. We didn't even really have to model that in the report because just showing what the bringing people together around a more affordable option can save, I think, is pretty convincing evidence. And so we can do a whole lot more work there. Steve Falke from Barnes & Noble was a member of the task force. He's a member of our current working group. And he's supportive of bringing together faculty from different campuses to look at what a shared content might look like for those courses. And then, as I've mentioned, another key finding in Penn State Advantage is our significant expertise in the investment in instructional design. When you look at our peer institutions, not many have the same kind of community of practice and expertise around instructional design that Penn State does. And so this is a great opportunity to get more resources and to really work with that community here to get more affordable or different licensing models for the material into those courses. And it's something that we've built up nicely here at Penn State. It's something I think we can really use to reduce costs and drive innovation for these courses. So the task force wouldn't have done its work if it didn't make a few recommendations. And if you go back to one of the things we found is that there is great work underway and was when we were charged, but it's not necessarily coordinated or presented in a way that allows us to take advantage. So one of the recommendations was that a coordinating position be developed in university libraries, that's what UL is there, to work with Julie Lang in teaching and learning with technology. The real specifics here are that teaching and learning with technology and university libraries were identified through the work of the task force as two central units that work with all different disciplines and multiple sites at Penn State that were already working in this space and could coordinate better and dedicate more dedicated expertise and a higher level of FTE, basically, for this effort. And so that's the first recommendation. We did look at a few different consortia, and the task force suggested that we leverage our existing membership in Unison, a new membership in a consortium called OERU, and the Open Textbook Network as our first consortial partners. Kind of lay those out and see what we're getting from each of those before we decide on other consortia to join or consider, because they were all very different. And we could talk a little bit more on the next slide about the Open Textbook Network in particular. But Unison gives us a great opportunity to partner with member institutions on developing and hosting affordable and open content through the infrastructure that they're putting together technologically and from a overall faculty development and support infrastructure that's being developed through Unison. OERU broadens that a bit and really puts us in contact with some of the leading open universities. When you look at that list, it's not necessarily the peers that we typically will compare ourselves to, but it's institutions like the Open University that are on that list. And the idea there is to contribute courses to the OERU consortium and be able to pull from that consortium. Although a lot of what we're talking about is open, one of the things, and we're one of them, a lot of institutions struggle with is providing a really strong platform to make it shareable and completely open. Dutton is a great example, and Annie Taylor and Steve Urocco will tell you, they have great content, it's wide open on the web. If you want to incorporate that into your own learning management system, you have some challenges there. And so OERU might be one of the ways that we can get around some of those challenges. And I'll describe Open Textbook Network in just a moment. We recommended creating a faculty development and incentive program, kind of like the blended learning model that's been pretty successful for TLT, Teaching and Learning with Technology. And we'll talk about the first steps on that in just a moment. Programmatically leveraging licensed content from the library in courses. We have a pilot underway to take a look at that. We recognize the need to develop a strategy for hosting locally created OER. And so this might be through Unison, it might be through a secondary system, it might be an expansion of what ScholarSphere does, but we know that we need to develop a strategy. Right now, a lot of what's been developed has either been one-off projects by faculty or been part of some of the pilots through Unison or supported from a department, and so they have a lot of infrastructure support, and that's not scalable, and we know that that's not scalable, so we need to solve this issue going forward. And then to develop a university-wide strategic plan for OER and affordable course content. So what's underway? Right now we have a national search underway for an open education librarian. We're hoping to have that person in place by midsummer, certainly by the fall semester. And this would be a partner for Julie Lang. This would help with getting materials into courses, identifying existing open educational resources, doing a lot of outreach and programming with faculty, with Julie and other groups that are interested, and looking at what we already license that and how those can be solutions for courses. For the fall semester, University Libraries launched a new platform for course reserves. And it's embedded right into Canvas in a really seamless way. I don't know if any of you are using the new course reserves platform, but that's given us a really great entree into Canvas and a really nice platform to explore and to pilot some other ideas, and we'll talk about that when we talk about next steps in just a moment. We did join the Open Textbook Network. We joined in January. What the Open Textbook Network is it's a faculty development and outreach program, essentially, on the train-the-trainers type of model and approach. We designate a representative to the Open Textbook Network, or a couple of them. The first steps in that process are Open Textbook Network trainers will come out to your site. We were able to negotiate with them that all of the Penn State campuses can be part of that training, so we'll do it through MediaSite or some other technology. Faculty who go through the training are then encouraged to and asked and supported in doing reviews of books that are in the Open Textbook Library, and offered a small stipend to do that. And so that's all planned for the fall. We're looking at Open Access Week, which is in October in the fall. They're able to model that about 40% of the faculty who review books in the Open Textbook Library are, they adopt open textbooks either through the Open Textbook Library or some of the other major repositories like OpenStax. And so these are existing resources, but the idea is that the exposure and having faculty look at the quality and what's available has been shown to give at least a 40% adoption rate. You know, here that could be really exciting because it's not very expensive to be a member. The stipends are not a significant financial obstacle. The Open Education Summit that we had last year drew over 100 participants here and at the campuses. And there was no stipend involved, and no money involved or anything like that. And it wasn't training, it was really awareness. And so if we could have a similar day in October, and we have 40 or 50 faculty who have open textbooks, it'll pay for itself really quickly for students. Faculty Engagement Awards in TLT this year focused on open educational resources, and we'll hear about some of the support and some of the projects, or one of the projects at least, that came from that. And then there are a couple of really promising Unison initiatives. We have 8 or 9 faculty who have content that they've developed through the Unison Pressbooks platform. This is an open textbook authoring platform, and we've made really good use of it really quickly. It just became available going into the fall semester. In one case, we have a colleague at Harrisburg who's saving our students $225. That's the cost of the textbook, and it just kept rising on that course. And so the thought was, well, I can do better. It's a lot of work, and we recognize that it's a lot of work, and part of the strategy is to support that work through the libraries, instructional design, and other means. But it's really promising to see that used so quickly and so nicely. The other promising Unison opportunity is through a platform that they have called Engage. This is around a course licensing fee model, and rather than an open text or a textbook model. The way that these work with publishers and the way that it works through Unison is that you have students pay a course fee. When we talk about affordable and open, a couple definitions are probably necessary right now. On average, and this is a very conservative average, if we want to be very conservative in when we model savings, we can assume textbooks or resources cost students about $100 on average. At Penn State, it's probably closer to the $150, maybe even $200 range, but let's be very conservative. And so when we talk about open, obviously those are completely free and you reduce that cost. If anything, maybe there's a print-on-demand cost for some of the major repositories if students really want a print copy. More affordable, we're looking to cut that in half. So we have a threshold of about $50 for those costs, and those could be through more affordable textbooks, they could be through more affordable courseware, or like this, the course fee model. The way that these work, you have to have all students pay. It's kind of like some healthcare models, one would say, where everyone's in the system, and then that allows the publishers, the vendors who are involved, to say, okay, I know that I'm gonna have 30 people in this course pay a fee. Right now, you don't know how many people are going to buy the textbook. And so they discount the materials by about 70%, so it's significant. And it gets us well under that $50 range. Most of these look like about a $30 investment with an option for students to buy a print-on-demand. So in order to really pilot this well, we'll be hopefully by the spring piloting it at a couple of different sites. Between TLT or the strategic planning or the libraries, we'll pick up the student fee for the pilots and then have a really strong assessment program for it. Because the main benefit to students, in addition to driving down costs, is first day access. And the idea is that with textbooks, students are left to whenever they feel it's necessary to get the material or if they can afford it. With the licensing fee, they have the content on the first day, and then they persist to have it in the Engage model, they have it as long as they're a Penn State student. And so and if we want to actually pitch this as an idea, we really have to assess whether first day access makes the difference that we think that it does. And so that'll be part of what we pilot with students before we ask to add another fee as all the other fees are coming off the schedule. A couple of next steps. You've already heard that the new OER working group was charged as part of transforming education. I'm chairing that group. A couple of members are in the room. The charge of that group is really to implement the recommendations that were in the task force report and to gather ideas for other pilots and initiatives over the next few years. We've set a goal of trying to transition 100 courses or sections each year for the next 2 to 3 years. To open or more affordable options through this really multifaceted approach that you're probably seeing emerging, using some of the licensed content, using completely open content, or faculty-authored content through some of the support mechanisms that we've talked about. You may have remembered that there was a slide or mention of using licensed content from the libraries more programmatically. This spring, we looked at what it would take to implement a model kind of like what the University of Minnesota does, where we proactively put into course reserves content that is already licensed or can be licensed by the library. These are typically not textbooks. These are typically academic books, university press books. So the way that this has worked, we have worked with World Campus to get all the course adoptions for the spring to work out the mechanics and now for the summer. Just to throw some numbers out there, it's not every course that we can license academic material for. A lot of them do use traditional textbooks or are already open. It's difficult to say. But the gap there is that it works nicely in this multifaceted approach. A lot of the academic books or university press books are used in upper division courses and in an affordable course content or OER strategy. that's kind of a gap. There's a lot that's available at the foundational level, at the introductory level, and then it kind of falls off. So this gives us an opportunity to try to work at different points in the curriculum. We looked at what we could do for the summer. We're going to pilot in the summer with about 10 to 15 faculty around some of the communication, make sure students are aware of what we're doing before we license a lot of content. The way that this will work, if that works out nicely, and we anticipate that it should, is that we'd be able to do a full pilot in the fall where we designate a budget, just to give you an idea of some of the numbers involved. In the summer, of all the courses that are being offered on World Campus, about 139 of them, about, right? I have an exact number. 139 of them have options where we can license or already licensing academic books for them through the library. And so, and that would cost us about $20,000 to license everything for the summer. And that's about in line with what we've anticipated. Minnesota spends about $40,000 a year for all their courses. So we're bigger and more complicated, you can imagine. If we're really conservative, if out of the 139, if it's $100 a textbook, and you have about 30 students in each course, and the projections actually end up averaging out to about 30 people enrolled in the course, you know, that's about $477,000 in savings for a $20,000 licensing. Now, you have to have students use them. They may prefer print. You know, not everyone would, but that's the potential here in being really strategic in how we license some content. And it gets added to our collection so that repeat courses that are using the same university press book, that's already licensed. We can move on to the next. And the way that that works is we look at what's already licensed. Great, we add it to the course through that platform I talked about before. We look at what's inadequately licensed. We increase the license so that multiple users can use it. We add it to the course. And then we do one more round to see what is not licensed at all and what does it cost to do that. And so if we max that out, it's about $20,000 for a semester, and the anticipation is that it goes down after you've built up a core of these materials. And then I talked about the faculty development and incentive programs. There are a lot of ways to get started on that, and we had one handed to us really nicely with the Office of General Education doing the faculty seed grants this summer. This will not be the only strategy, but we wanted to be really focused in the way that we did this. So we partnered with the Office of General Education. When faculty filled out their seed grant applications, and they received 134 of them, so this is a very popular program, the faculty were able to indicate a lot of different services or partners that they were interested in working with. They're also able to indicate, I'm interested in making this open or more affordable. And so from those faculty, if they're supported because of other parts of the proposal, we will be able to give them more services and support, knowing that they're just indicated that they're open to being open. We'll give them more support and try to fit it within this open or more affordable, $50 or less. And these are brand new courses, so it'll be difficult to know exactly how much we save, but if we do that conservative $100 a course for a lot of brand new courses that will enroll probably up to their cap, because they're going to be fitting that integrative studies requirement and part of a very small sample of courses to do that, there's some potential savings and pretty exciting development there. So before we hear about what some of these projects look like from the faculty perspective or what the outcomes have looked like, what questions might you have for what we've done or are planning to do, or suggestions? And we'll have more opportunity for open discussion, but I wanted to make sure I left some time now.
We are going to ask you to speak into the mic because we do have online guests.
I just have a question about the, is it the $30 or the you compared to the healthcare of OER? Is that something students would be forced to pay into?
Yeah, that's part of the way that it works, right? So the model works by guaranteeing to the publisher that you'll have a certain number of students rather than, you know, leaving it up to the market, right? And so in order to actually say whether we want this to be part of our strategy, we need to assess it. And so the first pilots, students won't have to pay a course fee. It'll be picked up, and then we'll assess those types of questions, you know, knowing that this was at this cost level, and how did this material work? Would you be willing to pay a course fee versus the overall fee? And report that out before we ask for any additional fees.
So it's pretty much the same as the existing course fee model that some some areas of the university already implement?
Yeah, it's similar to like the e-education institute has a similar one, but in that case there's not really an alternative, right? And and I don't mean that in a negative way, that's locally authored content that's really specialized to the course. And so in this one, you know, the other option is to make it completely, is to use the same content, but to use a different pricing model. And so I think we need to ask questions about, you know, if that's preferable for students. And to assess that first day access. We have a couple, like the E-Education Institute is a good example, where they have first day access as well. And so we can use that as part of our assessment as well.
Okay, I don't know that I totally agree with you that it's open, but I think it makes sense financially, but I don't know that I would consider that OER.
Well, we wouldn't either. We would consider part of the affordable course content strategy. So one of the things we try to do is incorporate OER as part of a larger strategy around reducing costs.
I see. All right, thank you.
Yeah, I'd agree with you on that. It's not open.
Yeah, I had a similar question, Joe, when you were kind of outlining it. So if I could just recap, there are basically sort of three models. One is, and I appreciate your expanding on the fact that it's not just OER, there's other dimensions of ways of reducing costs. So one is licensing, using licensed material that we already have access to. The second is using externally available resources, perhaps through Unison or other consortiums. And the third is generating Penn State material that from what I understood you said, that would be mostly accessible to the Penn State community, or would that also go into a larger bucket?
I think the preference is that it would go into a larger bucket. And, you know, even things like Unison, if we contribute to those, that's part of the strategies to make it go into a larger bucket. You know, working with faculty, I think the intellectual property questions, they are questions, and I think that's one of the recommendations that we received from the library. The library had a task force as well to look at the library-specific implementation. This is an area where I think the working group needs to work with general counsel and the library's copyright officer to figure out more of that strategy too. There's a large education piece of that, and then there might be some updates around it, the intellectual property policy in the next couple of years if we really want to have as much course material open as possible.
Hi, Joe. Thanks for the overview of where the committee has come. I currently support residential instruction, and it looks like your focus right now is on World Campus courses. So I guess my question is, how would a residential instructor tell if their materials were available on a licensed, in the library, or if there were licensed materials, and would they contact this new library position? Is that kind of the workflow that you're envisioning for this?
Yeah, I think the overall workflow needs to be worked out a bit. One of the strategies we have, especially with new initiatives like this, is to, you know, get the people in place and let them build out what that service looks like. But I would imagine either through the library or that OER website, just having a contact form to get help. I agree with you, the current, at least the course licensing, the current course licensing pilot is really focused on World Campus, but part of that's just because we could get all the course material adoptions from the World Campus. And so it's one of these where we could work out some of the infrastructure, we have really good partners there, we know how to get it set up, and then we've said in a couple of different audiences that we then need to figure out how to do similar kind of work for residential instruction. And it might be a simple step during the pilots of letting people know what we've licensed most recently and letting them opt in and letting the library add that to the course, because the licensing that we're doing for these materials is really, I mean, it's what we need for these types of courses. So if you're supporting a course and there's a great book that's available, you know, more traditional resource, because of the pilot, we want to make it available as well. Thank you for your questions, both of you.
Renee? Joe, can I ask you a small favor?
Anything.
Would you mind grabbing the mic and drifting, and then Haley's going to help Anita get set up.
Okay. I'm not going to go too far because I think they need to see me.
Hi there, Renee Ford, Smeal College of Business. I have two questions, actually. One is whether or not you're getting pushback from the like, say, Pearson and McGraw-Hills. And the other is for students who would perhaps want to refer back to course materials post-graduation, are you looking into strategies for making that content accessible post their Penn State experience?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I think it's one we need to, thank you for your question, by the way, that we need to do a little bit more programmatic data gathering on. We have talked with students who see a trade-off there, because even in the open environment, unless we want to gather, and this might be part of the strategy that emerges over the next year or two, unless we want to gather copies of those open textbooks, it's not as sustained or reliable, perhaps. I mean, that's the thought, is that they could move or be revised past the point of what it was like when it was used in that course, or not be the reference material that you would want. The licensing structures are certainly not going to support that. They license for the time that a student is here, typically. And then what we get to do through the library, a lot of those will not be available unless they're available through the alumni library that the library provides. To alumni association members, and so it is a trade-off, potentially, or it's something we need to understand if it's a trade-off that students are willing to make. And so, yeah, I think we need a little bit more data. We haven't gotten pushback yet. Students seem to understand that, but I think it's a good question.
So we have some time after our faculty guest do some showcasing. We're going to have some more time for some dialogue. So hopefully this will get your brains going. How about it'll open up your mind, right, Stephanie? Open. Okay, so Anita Serrano from Lehigh campus is going to share with us some of her work. And I think if you bring that down, will it tilt down for you?
Yeah.
It just won't stay down. There you go. Perfect. Thanks, Anita.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good afternoon to everyone. I am Anita Serrano, and I am an instructor in Spanish at Lehigh Valley campus. I've been working for Penn State since 2013 or 2012. I can't remember. It's been so great. Anyway, I'm going to try this. As you can see, somebody that is really good with computers, in this case, Julie, is the one that really needs to help, because I'm not that great with it. But as soon as I saw this call for content and participation for the OER, I was really excited, because for a long time, since I've been teaching, I taught at the University of Colorado in Colorado, and here in Pennsylvania at Millersville and Susquehanna University as well. And I felt for my students, because I remember being a student and not having enough money to buy my textbooks, and it was always a decision. I mean, do I go and get something to eat, or do I get my textbook? For me, my textbooks were always very, very important. So, needless to say, the idea of having something free for the students that has high quality and observe the communication, the skills, and the culture of language acquisition was very appealing to me. And one of the things that really inspired me is the fact that the students are paying over $200 for a textbook. There's a lot of pushback, not right now, from Pearson or McGraw-Hill. Unfortunately, there's a lot of pushback from a lot of faculty members from some universities that are not really happy about it. Because in the past, they have made money, and I can say that textbooks are really good too. I'm not saying that they're bad, but there's a lot of things that we don't use. In my case, my biggest example is travel agencies in a textbook in Spanish. It's not very practical nowadays because we have the internet. So if we have that kind of lessons with today's vocabulary, that really helps. No need for a student to pay over $150 or $200 for a textbook that it doesn't have a lot of things that are very practical. So an OER, no cost, the control over the content, because actually all of us have been on the same spot where you have a textbook, and out of the textbook, if you use 10 things out of a chapter, is a lot. You do have that control, and you look at it, and you're like, oh, I'm not going to use that. Well, that doesn't make any sense. Or that didn't work. So based on that, I thought, well, then I can have something free for the students that is practical, up to date, and they don't have to pay for it. So for me, actually, I think it's more important to grab a student's attention by a lifelong learning than just, I'm just going to give you the information so you can have the test, so you can go to the next level. So every time that a student is in one of my classes, for me, is supremely important that this is another course that I don't need, that I don't want, that doesn't make any sense to me. I don't want that. I want them to say, you know what, at the beginning, I don't want to do that, but at the end, I'm learning something. And in the end, in the future, I'm going to use this for something else. So $337. You cannot take your book with you if it's an ebook. And unfortunately, sometimes the students cannot take, for example, a Spanish class 1, 2, and 3 subsequently. So they have to wait perhaps 2, 3 semesters down the road. And guess what? The access is not good anymore. Therefore, they have to go and pay one more time. So with the OER, the idea is that they have access while they're here in the university, hopefully beyond that too. The information that they're getting in the textbook, although very important, always going over the learning objectives, that's very important, but that they can be life learners. Now, this is a screenshot. It has been very easy. Of course, because I have Julie, I couldn't have done it myself. But it looks easy, and I was giving some leeway to go in and change some of the things, and it wasn't that hard. I was a little afraid that I might do something wrong with the whole thing, but I didn't. So easy is appealing. A lot of the students really like it, and lifelong learning. I know in Lehigh Valley, I don't have a single student that is looking towards a PhD in Spanish. So they are just filling the requirements. So based on that, my audience, a lifelong. So I have IT majors, psychology majors. I also have corporate communication and the other ones. The table of contents, very easy to go over it. They just open the book, they press on the link, and it goes exactly where they want to go. They also have exercises that they can do there, which is done by H5P. I always say it wrong. And it's very interesting. We did at Lehigh Valley a very informal, very informal survey. I'm not a survey person, but somebody in there helped us do that, and we wanted to do it in a way that we weren't putting words there, that we really wanted to see the results. So 60% very satisfied. Most of them are satisfied. You always get one or two that actually won a book. So, but I think for the first edition, for the first time, I think that's pretty great. Now, the information contained in the book, the 56% of them agreed that it was straight to the point and what they needed for according to the learning objectives and the outcomes as well. Now, it has the material I need to be successful. To me, I'm pretty excited about that. So, and not spending the money, number one. So what am I doing for the future? Moving on, we have collected a lot of information and data on how the students are utilizing this resource, and we're getting the feedback, incorporating those changes into that first edition to get a second one, add some content. They have, can you believe it? They have asked for more exercises. They actually said that on the survey. We wish there were more exercises. And I got it. I got it. But in the meantime, I think for the first time, it was pretty good. So now we know. I'm preparing myself. I already have the table of contents. Somebody at the very beginning of all this, you need to talk. And I'm like, what is a talk? Table of contents, I didn't know. So now I can say confidently, I have to talk for Spanish 2 and 3 ready. So this summer, I will be spending my summer writing for those two. I have used some content that I have seen that is very good online, that is open resource, but most of it has been my own, where I know what has worked and has not worked throughout the years. And hopefully I'll get some of the faculty members at Schuylkill and University Park to help with Spanish 2 and 3 as well. That would really mean a lot to me because it's for our students. So, any questions?
So I have a quick question for you. So you're speaking now of springtime. You will be authoring material for as OER materials for 2 and 3, Spanish 2 and 3?
Yes.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
Can I ask, Anita, have you found that using OER materials changes the instructional design of your course?
It does. It's, but in a positive way.
Oh, I was hoping that. But.
I just want to say Anita was a participant in the TLT Blend initiative, so she changed her course into a blended format. So I think that provided an opportunity for her to kind of work with OER and also moving into that blended format.
So I completed the TLT blended course, and what I did was that I took that as an opportunity to a blended course to have an OER book, and that's how we're doing it. To be honest, I think it has been working really, really great. The blended side of it and also the OER, very easy for the students.
So would you mind, and I don't want to take all the questions, I don't want to ask all the questions. If there are others, please put your hand up. But I'm just curious if you could illustrate one or maybe 2 points when you say it changed it to the positive, when it improved. So one is, I'm going to presume, if I might, that access to material that might have been different than the way you were thinking about teaching it, and that helped stimulate new ideas about how to teach that content, that would be a positive one. Were there other examples of how it helped to improve your course?
Student engagement. Mm-hmm. It's one of those courses that a lot of the students are like, I remember being a student, and I'm not a science person, and I remember, why am I taking this course? And of course, now I know, but then I didn't. So based on that, so student engagement has been a big positive, and also the easiness of them being able to access the material. And like you guys were talking earlier, they have the material on the first day of class. We're not waiting for them 3-4 weeks down the road to start with the materials because they don't have the money. It's right there. It makes a difference. It really does.
Terrific. Chris?
Sort of a complex question, but since you brought up the Blend LTE part of this, mm-hmm. I'm guessing that when a faculty member decides to replace some traditional textbook with OER materials or these inexpensive materials, that they take the opportunity to redesign their course, and it's not just about taking the textbook, the traditional textbook, and replacing it with something equivalent, but rather doing OER, maybe taking bits and pieces of things that they find that they have licenses for, but then also doing some blended thing. So in the blended LT, you didn't just do this textbook. You probably designed other online activities for the students to do and interactions and stuff like that. So it wasn't just about, you know, swapping A for B, but sort of re-envisioning. So if you could talk about more broadly about what went into this, but then also maybe from like a faculty development standpoint, if you could shed some light on, for other faculty that might be looking to go down this road, sort of what, is that how faculty need to approach this as a redesign of their course? Is that the better way to go, or, yeah?
I guess it depends on how you would like to do it. It was easier for me to do the blended course and then work around what I was doing with the OER and then implement. But before all of this and the blended course as well, I have always been very inclined into going along with technology, today's technology, and implementing that in all my classes. The biggest pushback is because it's a second language acquisition, and you need to hear the students and you need to see them in order to make the proper assessment. However, I've been using VoiceThread, I've been using Adobe Connect, because a lot of the students don't like to be in front of everybody else. And a second language is even worse. So based on that, what I've done before, the blended and the OER, I did the Adobe and the VoiceThread, so they can just go do it, and I'm the only one who's seeing this and doing the assessment. So it was kind of like first using the technology, then moving to the blended with having in mind the OER all the time.
John?
Anita, you mentioned that the amount of student engagement, or the way in which your students were engaged in your class increased as a result of this. I wonder if you could speak to how their sense of ownership maybe changed a little bit with regards to the content and the course and the activities. Did that increase? What did you observe?
I'm not sure if I don't understand.
Feel like they were more participating in the learning process in terms of giving you more feedback, in terms of, like you said, they wanted more activities, they wanted more examples or more different types of materials?
They wanted more exercises within the textbook. We do have, I always think about 1, 2, and 3. First I presented, then 2, let's go and do it, let's see how it works, and then 3, then I can see what you're doing. So we kept it to about 3 exercises per grammatical concept or any other skills. But they seemed like they want more because it wasn't too long or busy work or anything. It was straight to the point. So they really, really like it. And every Tuesday and Thursday when we do the class with Zoom conference, they are all participating. They really like it. They have their books open. It has been really good. They feel part of it. They do.
Thank you, Anita. We're going to transition, if that's okay, to our next faculty. Please thank me. Thank me. Thank Anita for joining us today. Yeah, thank you too. But thanks, Anita. Really appreciate you presenting your work. Haley is getting our next faculty member, so as we're doing it, let me make an introduction. This is Mike Gallus, and Mike is a faculty member. I want to say of chemistry, is that right, Julie? Physics at Schuylkill campus. And Mike was not able to be here with us live today, but he did agree to come in via Connect Pro through the media site system. So they've worked this out. Haley's got it worked out. So while they're working on that, we do have Joe and John with us here. Are there any thoughts or questions that have come up in your mind about the process? Because I have a small list. Do you mind if I go into some of those now? Mike, question?
I'm trying to wrap my head around this OER concept and the books that they're talking about. I was wondering if somebody could explain to me how this is any different than your notes. You could write really detailed notes and essentially make your own little OER textbook why aren't we talking about doing that?
You absolutely could do that. So, I mean, we're talking about, when we think of open educational resources, we're talking about content, and that can be all kinds of content, from lecture notes to videos to interactive exercises, quiz sets, the list goes on. And then what kind of platform you want to use to publish that. And obviously, in general, we're talking about an online format. But even in that format, you can get print-on-demand, too, so that you could partner with the bookstore so that your students can get very cheap physical texts that then are enhanced by the online components, which, again, they can freely access to do exercises or interactivity or whatever you would. Well, potentially. It depends on what you're using as your platform. So, I mean, the university is paying for Canvas, our new learning management system. So in that sense, yeah, that's a fixed cost. But there are a number of other services online, other platforms online that may be freely available and that the university would not necessarily have to pay any fixed cost to. Or, you, again, the university might decide, let's invest in this because the scalability of it and the cost that we pay to scale it across our university reduces the cost so much that it's worth investing, you know, X number of dollars for, you know, thousands of students.
I can show you my workflow if you're interested. I do a lot of OER production for my own coursework. A lot of it is just putting the right license on your notes, putting it somewhere that's accessible, preferably for free. Not really. If you're, you know, at another university, or I don't use either of those systems to host it, but I use GitHub, for instance, to host my OER.
So one of the thoughts was, oh, Joe, response?
For the absolutely open part of it, that's part of the strat or the need that we've identified. We don't have a good locally hosted solution. I mean, we have a few repositories and systems to do that, but if we want it to be completely open, identifying just a fewer options than what we have available and really focusing there would be best. So you could put things like that in ScholarSphere or on your own personal website or something like that, but it may not be the best integration. It may not be, you know, the best home for it. So we know that that's a need. But in the meantime, Canvas, Unison might be options, especially Unison, because they're looking to create an option where it will live in the Unison consortium, but then you could like rights manage it and say, I want it to be completely open.
But now you're talking about sharing this with others. I thought we were worried about our students getting
things expensive. No, so that's...
Could you repeat that, Joe?
Yeah, the question is whether we're talking about sharing with everyone or just our students. The task force, that was, I guess, the lowest bar was our students. The ideal situation, if we could be completely ideal, would be that every institution would have a lot of work in this area.
Testing.
And would make it completely open so we could take advantage of what's at other places. But at the very least, to make it available here.
Testing.
Okay, thanks. And as I said, we will we'll come back to some of these questions. Woo-hoo! It sounds like we have Mike on the mic. Good deal. Thank you, Pat. So, Mike, you're live if you want to take us through your session.
Okay, I am still on, apparently, the 15-second delay, so apologize. All right, so I'd like to thank Julie for inviting me. So I just called my slides OER and Me, with apologies to Michael Moore, but my experience has been quite positive. My motivation, I've been a faculty member since 1990, which was before the web was young. NCSA Mosaic was just coming out in the early 90s. The visual web was growing. Also, as a professional in research, there was a now well-established archiving of preprints, which was a very cool way to quickly get versions of materials. It was kind of a before official share and discover of research. For me, in terms of curriculum materials, 2000 was when the web really became more fruitful in terms of locating curriculum materials, looking for things that I could use in the classroom, but also between usage and accessibilities that the students could access outside the classroom, looking for things that were engaging, possibly interactive. I was also interested in creating materials myself, so I was also looking for open source tools to aid with that creation. All right, so personal history examples. My first discovery of really cool things on the web in the mid-1990s was live weather maps from the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Agency. That used to be exciting. Now that's kind of every day you get that just to check your weather. All right, so personal experience, continuing on after my distraction. Fizzlets, an open source physics, began emerging early 2000s. Easy Java Simulations was one of the major toolkits for developing interactive materials. Tracker Video Analysis was an open source video analysis tool, great for the laboratory experiences. Paul Falstadt had a, well, still has a bunch of things open that were interactive, Java-based, now JavaScript-based. His stuff, very popular, open, but not a regular open source. He's not actually an instructor. He's an engineer that likes physics, that likes to share stuff. I also began making use of WebWorks, an open quiz system, making use of locating materials through places like Merlot and the National Science Digital Library databases, discovering things like FETs, interactive materials. So lots of stuff began emerging over this first decade of the web. In terms of textbooks, I've been on the search for a long time for textbooks. A worthy read is an article from the physics teachers. For me, the biggest punchline was students don't really see the textbook or use the textbook the way most teachers think. And so recognizing that they don't make what we would think of as teachers optimal use of those resources made me change my strategy a little bit. My textbook concerns for almost any courses were the expense, ancillaries, accessibility to students. We've heard talk about the issues of first day access, particularly for students reluctant to buy a textbook, and persistent access. I did try an electronic textbook, not OER, in 2008 for calculus-based physics, mostly because the students could access it easily from home, whatever computer they had a lot of interactive components for it. But there were some access hurdles. It was not universally accessible. I had some students who did not have computers that would run it, so that became problematic. More recently, for an associate degree program, a physics course I teach, I've adopted a Creative Commons licensed supplementary textbook to help them through their physics material. In terms of textbook alternatives, more recently I have turned to OpenStax, currently implementing first time through in the first semester of the Calculus-Based Physics and Astronomy 1. I will be implementing it in Algebra-Based Physics starting fall. And while I haven't had formal polls, I do get an opportunity to have informal chats with my students, and their reactions have been positive, especially about the cost. Access. They can access the textbooks anywhere, and some of them will access the textbooks on their phones, interestingly enough. And since reviewing materials and I have low-stakes quizzes where it's not so much them remembering things but being able to make connections, having a searchable textbook to facilitate their exploration of the textbook was a bonus to them. For me, the cost and access are tied together. I don't have to worry about students not grabbing the textbook on day one because of cost, and they're getting a third-party source for their textbooks down the line. I also like to make and share. I have an animations project that's been pretty successful. I use open source tools to create the animations. I'll add a little bit more to that momentarily. I'm also a participant in the open source physics project using Easy Java Simulations to create projects. And in both of these things, I've had students create materials as honors projects. I've also had the benefit of having a department server running Linux, open source, where I've been able to run an open quiz system. Better than the tools we have with Angel or Canvas in terms of science-type quizzes, calculation-type quizzes, probably comparable to some commercial systems. From my server, I host the animations project. I share materials with a Creative Commons license. And I also have, historically, most of my curriculum materials that are not encumbered with publishers' materials available online. I have my animations project on its own YouTube channel. Have in its 9 years of existence, has crossed over 4 million views. And as I said, I have some contributions to the Open Source Physics Archive. So just to kind of show you some of the things that I use, I've got a couple of quick videos, or at least segments of some videos. And this is my YouTube channel, by the way, Animations for Physics and Astronomy. This is one of the more popular types of animations. It's conceptually very simple, very short. I've cut out the audio, but it's really just an explanation of the conceptual differences between longitudinal, which we're seeing here, and transverse waves, which are here. And just to kind of gauge, I don't really poll my students too much about specific works, but some of the comments that have appeared about this in similar videos, quote, took me so long to find a video that was clear and made sense. Thanks. To the point, most productive 25 seconds of my life. And oh my God, 25 seconds of pure goodness. I have been looking for this forever. So a visual exposition can be very handy, and so I seem to be able to create some stuff that people find worthy, and so it to me logical to share this, and the YouTube channel has been fairly effective. Just to show you how crazy I can get with some animations, I have one, there's several segments here on physics of roller coasters, if you will. And this is just showing forces and energy of going around a loop. And the other part of this I want to share is that it's cool to watch a loop, but it's also cool, if I want to get the right one, yes, failure to go through a loop. So this is something where we can add a little bit of drama and discuss. It brings the students definitely come to attention, and of course the gratuitous first person view of this helps lock in their attention even more. So yes, you can see the oh my goodness moment right about there. So I, as I said, I have some contributions to the open source physics program. I'm just going to say that bungee jumping can be fun. So this is an interactive piece that I actually do a scale model bungee jumping. And of course, if you're going to do bungee jumping, you have to face the consequences of not doing it right.
Thank you so much for sharing those examples, Mike. That's really interesting. And I love the way that you are engaged with the community as well as not only using materials, but also creating and then sharing those materials out. I think it shows the cooperation and collaboration. It goes both ways. I don't think he was laughing at that joke. I think he was laughing at the previous joke, because that wasn't a joke. So let me, before I hand it over to the audience here, I just have one question. And Anita, this is sort of directed toward you as well. My question to you, Mike and Anita, is do you find material or the quality of material that maybe isn't of your to meet your standards? The best example I can think of is with Mike, where we show the apple actually falls from the ground upward. And we say, that's not the way it works. Do you have a sense, Anita? And then, Mike, I'm going to ask you in a second, percentage-wise, is it tested? Is it pretty good?
Pretty good, depending on what you're looking for. So when you guys were talking about the beginners, I'm sorry, my English is not my first language. The beginners, and then where we don't seem to find materials for the more advanced courses. I have found the other way around. A lot of advanced courses material. For example, linguistics, different kind of dialects in Texas, University of Texas, as an example, and I can't use that. So I have found a very good, the majority is really, really good. Some questionable, but the majority is very good, but it's too advanced for what I'm doing.
Is there a vetting process? Is there a review process that material, so when I access it, when I find a resource and I access it, I have some sense it has gone through a second set of eyes or a third set of eyes, or is it just put it up and we'll see what happens?
I have two professors as well that are native speakers and also teach at Millersville and Northampton Community College. Everything that I write, I send the content to them, and they look at it, and after that, we look at it again, all three of us, to pick up anything missing and making sure that the learning objectives are clearly defined and that we're addressing those things. So at least from my experience, absolutely, yes.
I'm going to ask Mike to... Mike, hopefully you can hear this in the timing. I know we're a little delayed. Have you found the quality of the materials that you've gone to access, have they been to your quality standards as well?
Let me start with visual materials. There are places like Merlot that do evaluations of visual materials. So there is some field testing. Within the physics education community, physics education research is a very active community, but they don't have the resources to evaluate the vast set of materials that's available. So usually you'll find groups associated with whoever's producing certain materials. I've tried to do more formal assessment of my own materials, but I don't have the numbers for that. For places like FET, and the Open Source Physics Archive, all those materials that are published do have second set of eyes, not quite peer review, but they are evaluated.
Wonderful. Thank you, Mike. That's a great answer. Appreciate that. Let me see, are there any questions in the room?
Rick? Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rick Dushaw. I'm in the College of Education, and you're anticipating exactly one of the questions I was phrasing, which is, I'll use the word, since we're in a library, what's the curation of the quality of the materials that are being used? And I think that that's an exciting R&D prospect. I mean, it's something that we should be investing in over time. And I was going to ask the same question that you asked of our guest from Schuylkill about, you know, the physics community. I am a science educator. And so I am aware of the sort of the leading role that the physics community has made in this area. But, you know, when I think about the curation, some of the things come to mind is, you know, how are the activities designed well? How is the mediation that opportunities? In other words, the activity, does it enable mediation feedback on the part of the learning? What are the tools that you're giving to the learner to use? We talk about design principles, as you did, you know, which ones are effective, which ones are not. We talk about, does the activities, the tools, help make thinking visible on the part of the learner so that you can begin to make the appropriate kinds of assessments? So, you know, this, and then, of course, the broader idea of the learning goals as well. So as a science educator, Mike, I'm interested in the conceptual learning, but I'm also interested in their ability to reason systematically or to use model-based reasoning. As we know, the physics community has given us a lot of insights of the importance of learners being able to model the system. And you were showing the roller coaster as an example of a model system with gravity and acceleration and forces and all those kinds of things. I think that it's possible to begin to think about, you know, what are our own, inside our own family here at Penn State, you know, how do we set up advisory boards? how do we set up our own curating process of editorial boards as it relates to the different areas of specialization that our broad community can bring about?
I would say to a certain extent there are already cross-institutional communities. And I think the Open Source Physics Archive is a small part of what is called Compadre. And Compadre is the physics education branch, if you will, the National Science Digital Library. I would, rather than necessarily growing our own, I would encourage, and there's probably similar communities in other fields, I would think there would have to, but I would encourage and recognize faculty who participate in those already ongoing efforts. Recognize that doing a peer review of materials from Merlot is a worthwhile event. And then bring it back home to our local community so that we have people who are participating in these topical communities are sharing their experiences with people in other fields so we can kind of see where we are and how we can improve in our participation.
This is Robert Snyder. I have a question that kind of goes with curation, which is persistence. To have either of you, Anita maybe, had situations where you had elements that you were relying on using that were not available or changed when you went to go use them in your class?
Good point.
I think that committees and evaluation, it's very important. However, what Julie and her department, they've been trying to do is for everybody to collaborate. And I think that would be our best kind of, how would you phrase it? Asset. That would be our best asset, that here we are collaborating, this is our family, this is our school, these are our students, and the importance of collaborating with each other, I think it brings a higher level of quality to whatever it is that we're doing.
So that's a thank you, Anita, and thanks for that question, Robert. That is a wonderful question and a really good segue as we start to draw to a close this afternoon. I've learned a ton, and I really thank you both to Anita and to Mike for being here today, and thank you for putting up with our little bit of a lag there. John, the people in the audience or online may be wondering, like, how do I get started in this? Like, where's the community? What do I do? Would you mind coming up and addressing that for us?
Sure. So what you can do to get involved at this point and learn more about what we're doing across the university when we look at the spectrum of affordable course content all the way to fully open content is you can check out a newly launched website. Julie Lang redid our open education resource website for the whole university, and it's newly launched. It's oer.psu.edu. And this is going to be the clearinghouse right now for the university when we look at the number of initiatives that are going on across the entire university at all the campuses. And there really is an amazing variety and amount of work going on by faculty across many, many different disciplines. What's really exciting is that that when you look at the quality of content that we can produce at this university, that the faculty can bring to bear in the production of open content, not only can we enhance the learning for our students, but we can enhance the learning for students around the entire world. And that's really exciting. And in that process, we're also benefiting our students financially in the sense that we're beginning to reduce the costs of that content. So to be able to enter into that conversation, to share your information, if you click on the Connect link that is on the far right of the navigation bar of the website, you'll see that there is a Yammer group, and for those of you who are familiar with Yammer, I need not say more, but if you aren't familiar with Yammer, it's a site that operates very similar to Facebook in terms of it's a social network site, except exclusively for, in this case, the Penn State community and the various groups that are in there, and we have an open educational resource group. There's over 100 people so far who have joined. We'd love to have as many people join as possible. We post information with regards to initiatives that are going on worldwide, but we also focus on what's going on at Penn State. So it's very relevant. There's great conversations, but usually it's very focused, so it doesn't have a lot of extraneous conversations. So I encourage you to find out more by checking out the website and going to the Yammer group and just joining the Yammer group. And with that, I will pass it back to Larry.
So thank you, folks. I know John and Joe will be around for a couple minutes if you have additional questions. We're at our time limit. Thank you for interest in the topic. Julie, I hear your name a lot, so I'm going to say thank you to Julie, working with our wonderful faculty members. And I think this is, since I was at the summit last year, I was very excited about the potential of this to help, as I said in the beginning, to address some of the issues that Dr. Barron has raised for us as a community. And a lot of exciting potential here. So thank you all.